So we have, by now we have discussed DSpace and the modifications we did. So if you want to play with our implementation, there's a lot of requirements that you need with softwares, and you have to install all of them. But if you really want to play, there is a Vagrant support that we provided. There is a GitHub project for that. You can simply instantiate a virtual machine based on Vagrant, and everything will be pre-installed, and then you can just play with our repository. So that's something nice. Then all this repository and the projects that I've mentioned separately, they are all on GitHub. We have a proper documentation, we have issue tracking, and we have a proper mailing list that you can use if there is any issue. We have some other projects like AI, lint.common. Lint.common is the one that we use for the common theme, the header footer, the ref box. We also have meetings every Monday at 12:30. You all can join if you have any problem. If you are trying to install the system, if you have any issues, you can come to the meeting and ask. We all are there every week. And you can also see list of events on our website. If there is any specific events, you can also join that. So whatever we have seen so far, I'd just like to show you in action. So this is actually the repository page. This is the live version. This is our theme that we have developed. You can see on the front page that there are some most used facets are there. People can directly click on that to see what's available. There are some new item facets. Whatever is top last week, it's there. Then you can see the item in detail. For example, these are the files, this is the license. We have a clear ref box. You can export it into different formats. Then there are some functionalities that are only for the authorized users. So, so this is the PIVIC status that we talk about. So you can see how many downloads are there for the last week, or you can select a date range. You can see the number of views and the summary.
Is that for the whole repository?
Yeah, so it's so the PIVIC is a separate application, but we have integrated these queries based on PIVIC.
But it's for that specific item,
yeah,
which
right,
is
okay.
In the WoW.
Yeah. Yeah.
You as an administrator, when you have access to PIVIC, you can get all the information directly from the PIVIC web application. We try to display only a couple of the information, and usually it's also not like performance optimized because we don't think that it will be really so much used like every day. So if you put there like 2 years, it can take a couple of seconds or maybe more seconds, but for us it doesn't really matter. If you want to have the statistics, you should subscribe to monthly statistics monthly statistics. So this is more for the authors really.
Then we have implemented this control panel that I've talked about. For example, I can show you a few of the things. So for example, there's a beta stream view in which, for example, you can change the formats if you like for all the beta streams and things like that, which was not part of the DSpace in the beginning. So this is
And this is the administrator view. Amir is an administrator, so on the right side he sees the administrator menu. Otherwise you would see only a couple of items there.
Yeah. And this is the submission forms. So you can see that everything is very nicely presented. So you can select different types, and as we have discussed already, that based on type there can be some different forms. And we have a very clear progress bar, that on which step you are, which steps you are going to take next. And yeah, I've talked about the support for
so maybe I'll just mention one thing. What we have experienced is that the curation is best really done by the users themselves, and when we offer them this list showing how many other items have already used this value, then usually they choose the right one. So before we had Charles University, mm-hmm. Charles University in Prague, Prague Charles University, and more, and so on. So if you start to type Charles, you will see the one item saying that it has 100 items. So we really hope, and this is our experience, and the user really select that one, which is really good, even though our university changed the names lately. But this is also what we try to achieve there. And we have in the control panel, like curation helper thing. Can you show that? Can you go to curation control panel? And there is the metadata quality, we call it. So we see when you select one of the keys, we see the outliers. So the number, the biggest count of that which is being used, the longest value, the smallest value, and we can change it easily here. So to do the metadata like curation here. But thanks to the suggestions, we haven't touched it lately. There was no need really. The values seem to be correctly chosen by the users.
Then, as we already discussed about some extra features that we added for the admin. For example, if the file is a local file, you can give a path of that file here, and it can be uploaded from here. This is the page for the selection of license. So, as I have already shown you, that we implemented a nice, easy to use. Question answer based license selector, in which you can answer a simple question that what it is, and you can select some of the features. So because most of the people that we have noticed that they don't know what license to choose for which resource, but they can answer some specific questions, and once they answer those questions, we can offer them suggestions that okay, this is the license that you want, and then they can select it, and it will be selected here. But if there is an advanced user, and that user don't want to go through the license selector, he can directly select from the list here. But the list is also nicely created. You can see different tags here, that it's a public license, it's academic license, or a restricted license, and so on.
Are Clarin licenses in there?
What?
Are Clarin licenses in there? I can see Creative Commons and a few others, but there are Clarin licenses as well, aren't
they? Oh, well, that's a good question whether there are Clarin licenses. Lawyers say those are not free licenses. But
I strongly suggest to postpone this topic afterward, because this is a very hot topic, I would
basically,
say.
Well, technically speaking, you can have any licenses in there.
Yeah.
So if you decide you want Clarin ACCA license, you just define Clarin ACCA and what attributes it will have and what labels it will have.
Okay, so that's the short answer. That's fine. I'm happy to that idea of the discussion.
Amir, can you then maybe also show how to create a new license afterwards, and it will automatically be shown there? So when the user says, "I want this new license," we try to tell him, "No, you don't." But if he really insists, then we will tell, "Okay, stop." Each step when you click on next, you have your submission saved, and then as admins we can create that license, and when he logs in again, he can see that license.
Yeah. So this is the license control panel where you can see the licenses, and you also see that how many bitstreams are actually currently using this license. You can define new license based on different labels, and on the basis of these labels, we will show different icons also, which is very easy to understand. That's good.
So and most of the labels are just things to help user and make an association, like a GPL label. They mm-hmm. immediately, people who know GPL license and see the logo, immediately make the association of the repercussions.
Yeah. Then we have these fields. For example, if you want the license to be public, you can select from here. But if you want that, and the user will always login, the user will always give some other attributes, or anonymous users can download or not. You can select from here based on the license, and then you can add extra information. So you want, for example, users to ask their country's address, or if there is any specific requirement, because we had this requirement for one of the license that users also enter some extra information. So we implemented this feature here, so you can also create your own license with extra information.
That is something that allows us to finally substitute the common system of distributing data, where people put it on their home page and create a web form of what they want to know from you when you download it, and then send you a link via email. And we got into a situation several times that we actually told those people, oh, you can put the data in a repository, it will be safe and all. And they said, but I want these particular things to know from the people, and only then get them the link. So we gave up, and now they can use exactly this way the repository. That it will email the link to the people after they fill in this information, but they don't need to do the HTML page. They just tell us we require these attributes. They clicked in here, and it generates the web form and everything, and then emails the link. So now it is finally equivalent to the homebrew version of making your own HTML page. But yeah, for the Clarin Akka, you would just fill in that it does require a login, right? Then you would say it has an Akka label, and it's in no redistribution, and click in a few of those switches, and that would be it. Of course, then you would still have a problem to solve of how do you make sure they are an academic user?
You don't know. Which is impossible.
And that's why we don't have it there, that's the short answer.
Or almost impossible.
But
in the general
but you could simply trust them, it's what we do with many licenses. We basically trust the users. We show them the rules, this is what the license allows you and this is what it doesn't allow you. And when you click OK, I agree, then we don't
so
check that, right? We don't,
yeah,
we don't police the users.
Someone sends you an email that he works on the university, these and these, do you check it? Rather not. You
well,
trust
they don't need to send an email, but they log in via their IDP.
Yeah, okay.
But you don't know if they're staff or
no,
if
we don't.
Research.
We don't. Yeah.
And now it comes to the AAI again, where the only requirement we have on AAI is that we require an identification because users can sign licenses. So in the theoretical case, when they breach the license and somebody finds out and asks us who signed these licenses, then we can tell these guys and this is their identification, and you can theoretically go to that IDP, to their home institute, and they will tell you, okay, this China user is that one, and you can sue him. Okay. The question is, where can you sue him? And a lot of other legal questions. But this is the theoretical, or this is the requirement we have on the authentication, to have an ID which can be tracked down to a user, not by us, but at least at the home institute. We actually don't require really an academic affiliation. We say that if somebody logs in through academic IDP, he is kind of affiliated with that. This is our policy. We are banning actively IDPs which we know are not are commercial testing or something like that. So this is what's all also mentioned in the footer, telling what are we banning. So we are actively trying to support these academics, but we gave up on really asking the user on this affiliation.
But let's not go into that AI stuff.
Yeah. So
slippery slope.
We also talk about the submission workflows. So basically, this is the interface where you can actually assign that who will do what. So who can submit to a collection, then how many steps you will take till the final, finally an item will appear in the repository. You can assign different accept, reject people. You can assign different people for editors, curators, and things like that. And you can also change this workflow by defining more steps, and then it will appear here, and you can just select who you want to assign to what step.
Could you make the text a bit bigger, please? Maybe
more even.
So else. This is the search screen. You can select different facets from here. You can do some advanced searching, and then the results will be shown like this. Is there anything else that needs to be shown?
Any questions to the functionality or what you would like to see in action here? Maybe can you show the metadata format? So we mentioned that we store in the key value pairs, and basically even if you see DC, for us it's only a key and we know the semantic meaning of that. So, but we have more, like also meta share, local DC terms, or whatever that means. But if you want to have a new metadata field, you would have to first define it either one in one of these, or you will have to create your own profile and just fill it there. And you can use whatever you want. So if you have a SIMD profile which has, I don't know, a very, very specific value you would like to store in the database, and maybe then use it for searching, you will just define it here and then you can start to use that. You would have to do one configuration change so it is included in the indexing, but apart from that, it's automated.
Maybe one thing you can show is the OAI interface. It's a web page. It also has a web view in our system, because that is a good place to demonstrate the metadata formats. So we don't store, for instance, CMDI files. We generate them from the internal metadata representation. So all those formats, CMDI, MODS, ORE, MEDS, all of that is generated by XSL transformations from the internal schema. So even when you have the citation box on the record, and you say give me BibTeX, it will simply generate it from the internal representation. And the same is true for OAI. When the harvester says give me DC or give me CMDI, it will simply generate it from the internal representation and send it over.
And what's the format of the internal representation?
I don't know. The guys know.
So can you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
What's the format of the internal representation of the metadata?
As I said, that's the key value pairs.
Yeah.
So I don't know how it is exactly written, but it's the simple key value pairs.
If you want to know the internals of the database, probably that's not the question, but actually it's a key, and then it's the value of that.
And that's flexible. You can define.
And you can use keys of any of those metadata schemata, as Amir showed. You just click to add a schema and add a list of other attributes. And then you can use them, you can mix them, keys from any schemata in one
in one record.
So the important thing is that we understand the semantic value of the key. If we name the key 1, 2, 3, and we know that it's a semantic value of a user, of a title or whatever, we can use that. But usually that's not the case. That's why we choose something more standard like the DC. So DC.author, and we know that we will put the author name there. Okay? But basically it's a key, and then that's a string value. We have implemented, as I said, the hierarchical components up to one level. So sometimes the key is like more complex one, but still is a string.
Yeah.
And we interpret it internally.
But everything is configurable either through some configuration files or through the interface. So for example, we have defined our own fields that we have some value. For example, these. And we interpret these in various different ways in our repository. Maybe this is not have some meaning for other people, but when we display something, we have some metadata associated with that that we have defined, and you can also define your own values, and you can also define those values in the forms, and you can ask user to input those values. Yeah.
You can see here that some of them are typically like help things for us, like for instance to have a count of all the of all the bit streams in the record, because
mm-hmm.
because you don't want to keep counting them or things like that.
Yeah.
Some of their sizes.
If I have, for example, my own complicated CMDI schema, I can click it here in the interface, but I also want to be able to generate the CMDI XML file. If I can do that out of the box, or should I need to develop some script or whatever which will gather data and turn them into my XML?
So you have several options. We have already discussed it in the first session, but the first option is that you will extract the required information, what we have here, like the title and the author, you will extract that, put it into this space database, and let our SIMD profile be let it convert to our SIMD profile, and that's it. First solution. The second solution or second option is that you will again make our Lynda this space happy regarding the required fields, but you will use a specific functionality where you upload the SIMD file, and that SIMD file will be shown through the OAIP image.
But you asked about the first option, right?
If you create the
schema in the internal way.
Then the third option is that you would again make our Lynda this space happy, plus you will add there the fields you are interested in, and then you will create a transformation from those, like we have for our own profile, you will do it for your profile.
Yeah, and this to prepare such a transformation, and to integrate it into this solution, I will have to write a Java class or
XSLO transformation.
Okay, XSLO.
Plus configuring two text files, man.
Okay.
That should be it. Should be automatically there.
Good. Thank you.
Okay, Amir, 1 hour to go.
Maybe I have one more question on this topic. So, in order for it to be valid, the SIMD needs to point to the repository, to the Clarin component repository where the corresponding thing is. How do I tell it? How do I make sure that this happens? If I make my own profile, or if I...
So again, what is being done when the SIMD is created, it gets as an input the key value pairs,
uh-huh.
and then an XSL transformation is being performed. Exactly. So in that XSL uh-huh. transformation, you would see that there is the header with that profile.
Yeah.
You can make more complex.
So this is actually what DSpace generates, and you can use this.
This is more.
And yeah. So this is
this
more
is
or
kind
less.
Of
yeah.
Too complicated, but basically the input are the key value
yeah.
pairs, and the XSL transformation can say, does this record have this specific field? Do the conversion into this profile.
Mm.
Otherwise, to this profile, and you would see in that profile, in the XSLR, you would see exactly what the profile
looks
like.
So in the end, it's my responsibility to make sure that this transformation outputs a profile that is actually conformant to what I'm declaring.
Yeah. But if you want to use like your own new profile, yes.
But
if you want to use what we have there,
those that
then
are there have
it's
been
working.
Validated against the profile that is being
sure.
deposited. But yeah, clear.
Mm-hmm. And as we shown you before that there is a possibility to integrate other services. So for example, we can directly go from here to context and it will show you that this data set is there and you can search here as well. So the different services are integrated together. Yeah, I think that's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one more time, any questions, any comments to this? Because now we will go through the Clarin B requirements.
I have a question. Is here a center which hasn't been assessed yet? And you are being assessed. but do you know what Clarin B assessment is? Clarin B Center, and do you know what are the requirements for a B Center?
Martin, did you raise your hand that you haven't been assessed as a B Center?
No, but I wrote the original rules for assessment.
So you wrote the rules, but you are not fulfilling them currently.
No, we're a C Center at the moment. We're not ready to sign to say that we think that we're curating things properly yet.
Okay, so please, if I skip something or tell something quickly and you would like to have more details, please ask me. So Clarin Center B, at the beginning, you would like to be a Clarin B Center and you chose to use Lynda DSpace, the Lynda repository. You have to obtain a server, public IP address, mail server which is working, some RAM, 1 gigabyte is not enough, and also some CPUs, and then external PIVIC installation. Usually it's on the institute level or something like that. So this is basically what you need, and a certificate. I will get to that. But for us, it's usually bundled with the server. But yes, that's hardware and operating system. Okay, so. And then what to do? AAI, I hope you already know what that means, but basically you have to register to your national federation. You have to register to SPF and include Clarin IDP. These are the requirements in order to interfederate with users from the service provider federation, which means 17 countries in Europe plus others. Regarding the persistent identifiers, you have to obtain a handle prefix either from Epic or your own handle. You have to install our repository, set up the handle server which is there, obtain data seal of approval which is an assessment of the repository, and register to the center registry. When you do this, then most of the assessment has you have met most of the assessment requirements. So the center requirements are divided into 8 steps. And now I have to admit that we haven't changed the. Have you changed this? Okay, so that was 1 year ago. I hope the numbering stayed the same. But basically, the first point is that you have to declare that you are doing something useful. We cannot help you with that. We can only tell that, or we can only offer you the repository services. Then you have to be, you have to make sure that Clarin is visible. Again, we can't help you with that. You have to prepare your own logo. You have to make sure that you set the proper IPR issues policies. Again, we can help you with that. We have set our own IPR issues. You can be inspired by that or start to use that, so we can help you with that. You have to make sure you understand what the Data Protection Code of Conduct is And we have again prepared all the text. You have just to make sure you understand and you comply with that. The third step, data seal of approval. We can help you with that because the Lindad repository has been assessed several times successfully in multiple centers, but it's not only about the repository, it's about the framework and infrastructure around that. SSL, as Menza correctly say, so certificates, trusted ones. Then you have to join. SIMD of AIPMH is the 6-point PI Design FCS. So the first thing, you have to get the SSL and join the National Federation SPF, include Clarin IDP, install the shibboleth and so on. So with these two, they can be done without Lindad repository. You should have this prepared before, or at least be on the way there. Does anyone want to get into the AI details? That can take long, and I'm more than willing to, but I got usually very excited about that. So, so anyone interested in AI? If not, then maybe I just also mentioned that there is something called EduGain, which is another interfederation, and you can be part of that. But basically the AAI is usually the thing which takes most of the time. You wait for the metadata to be accepted, to be propagated, and so on and so forth. Installing the shibboleth, you can use Apache as a web server or Nginx. Here are the links that can be used for installing that. We are using Nginx with shibboleth. In the year 2016, it's very good that usually it takes the sudo apt-get install apache if you are on Ubuntu or related. So it's really not that complicated that it used to be. But this is what you need. You need to have a service provider, and this is how you install that. But again, it seems that all of you are familiar with that. This is the configuration which you have to fill in to include the proper metadata feeds. So you should have Clarin there, Clarin IDP, and your national federation. So this is how it looks for us. We have there more, but these are the basics. So this means that you will tell your service provider, I am trusting those entities which are in this field. On the other hand, it has to be done the same by the IDP. So for example, you have to put your metadata into the SPF in Clarin track, and also you have to contact the National Federation. So they will include your metadata for the IDPs. Be careful, there is something called authentication and there is something called authorization. Those two are different. In our context, in the context of Lindad repository, they are the same. When you authenticate, you have already some authorization. You are not the administrator, but you have some authorization. We are only requiring an identification to a real person. ID of a real person. That's the only thing we have as a requirement. This has been based on our experience, because if we would want to have a specific ID, for example EPPN, we would limit our user to 60% of IDPs. So at the end of the day, we say that we require either EPPN or persistent ID or email. However, if your IDP home organization does not release mail, we will ask that anyway. So we always have to have an email so we can contact you, and we can also make sure that the reassignability of EPPN is solved by the fact that you tied the email together, and some other problems are solved by requiring these two. Relation to academic, we have spoken about that. we have several services on the Lindat, but also on the Clarin level, which helps in, for example, releasing the attribute. So there is a new service called Attribute Aggregator, which has been done for the Clarin Plus project. And we will automatically from service provider gather the information which attributes were released to which service provider. So if you are in SPF, you are more likely in time to get the proper attributes because we will notice that. If you are also part of the attribute aggregator, we will notice that and we will on behalf of you contact the IDP asking, begging to release attributes to your service provider or to Clarin SPF service providers. As I mentioned, because we are in EduGain, we are also blacklisting some of the IDPs, commercial ones, or the ones which have the entity category hide from discovery, which are usually the testing ones. It's not 100%, but we are monitoring again the IDPs that came to us, and if we don't like them, we will just blacklist them. There are some attributes mappings. You have to configure a shibboleth in order to get what you really want. On demand, we can give you our configuration. It's actually in the attributes.xml URL shown before. It's already shown there. But we are using some specific configuration because of the legacy and uncommon attributes. Okay, so that was AI. Any questions to AI, really? As I already told you, there is a task force meeting. You are more than welcome to join after the lunch. SSL, that's pretty easy if you have a good admin. But even in this step, we have found out many times the problems that the intermediate certificates are not return and so on. So this is a command which you can really make sure it's working. Why? Because Lindat DSpace is using is fetching some of the resources using Java, and Java is very sensitive to the proper certificates. So that's one of the requirements anyway to have a proper certificates, but when you see in the browser a green lock, it doesn't mean that your certificates are really good, because the browser browsers have their own keychains which they trust, and that's why Java doesn't have this, and you have to make it proper, even the intermediate certificates. So that's SSL. Then you have to provide a testing script. When a user comes to your server, he should know which attributes have been released. That's for the assessment committee to see whether it's working or it's not working. It's called ship_test. What you do is basically put it, you have to enable Perl because it's written in Perl. You have to put it to your web server and secure it with shibboleth. The guide on the Clarin EU webpage is, I think, good enough, and you can build on that. But again, you have to make sure that this is on your server. It has happened before that some centers like use the Clarin one, but it has to be on your server, so we know which attributes are released to your service provider. It's more for debugging purposes, really. Okay, so the shibboleth tester is a requirement, and as I mentioned, it's well documented, so it's not part of the Lindat DSpace anyway. However, we have a JavaScript library on GitHub. The link hasn't been updated, but it's on GitHub, which the Lindat DSpace uses in order to show you the list of IDPs and to configure the AAI. It's automatically on the wiki page of Linda DSpace, you can see how to set it up. Basically, it's cloning the repository and put it to specific location. You have to add the metadata of your service provider to Clarin. So you can see here the file where you should manually put that. And then Clarin will distribute it among the members of SPF. Okay, but your responsibility is to put it here to the Clarin SP metadata. You have to have an account for Clarin and the developer account, so you can ask for a developer account. You have to be able to log in on the SVN and then commit it there. You should also check that your SAML metadata are valid using the script which is in that versioning controlling system. Okay, if you need debugging, you can use some information from our wiki page. As I told you, AAI is usually the most problematic part when you first set the center up. But it seems that most of you have already done that, so it's not a problem. So let's say that we have the number 4 and number 5 solved, and we can move further. So now PIDs, what does it mean? It means that you have to have a persistent identifier. Does anyone or does everyone know what a persistent identifier and handles is? Okay, do you know? Perfect, so you have to have a handle. Okay, that's the first thing. You can have also DOIs, but as mentioned before, the Linda repository does not hasn't been tested with DOIs. DSpace supports DOIs, but we haven't been tested with DOIs. You can hack it. You can manually change the PID if you mint the DOI from somewhere. You can in the submission in the item edit item change it. So it's working, but automatically mint DOIs from Linda DSpace hasn't been tested. So what to do? You have to obtain a handle prefix either through Epic or you have to buy your own one for $100 the first year and then $50 the next, at least this for the prices before. You can request that at the handle.net. You have to make sure that the part identifier, which is really not part of the standard specification, is enabled. I will show you how later, but this is the really the only like internal thing you have to do. The Lindat platform, the Lindat repository supports handle prefix by your own handle server, but also we are supporting Epic ones. So for our own, the Lindat, the repository on Lindat, one collection uses the own handle server, the other collection uses the Clarin Epic handle prefix. And then what happens? When you register, your information is entered into the global registry database table. Basically, it says that on this IP address and on that port, the handle server is listening. And then through hdl.handle.net, the PID is resolvable. There are some technical details. If you want, we can discuss this, how it's being done. But you can test it appending the question mark and the parameters no redirect and also the auth. The no redirect means that it will show you what the handle server knows about that handle. It will not be redirected to your to the destination URL. And the auth means that it will direct, it will not use cache, it will ask the handle server with this request and it will get the latest data. So this might be handy if you want to debug what's the problem. The handle system is being used by DOIs, it's a well-established one, and there have been only a few minor issues with it so far. So this is the information I already told you. There is a guide on Wiki how to really install it, because there is a helper script which will create the configuration. It's well documented on the DSpace Wiki page. The handles usually are stored in the handle server themselves or in the database it uses, but the DSpace uses a very specific functionality where the handle server listens on a port, and when a request comes, the Lynda DSpace Java code is being executed in the background. So it touches the Lynda DSpace, the DSpace database. So this means that through the UI interface of Lynda, we can control the PIDs. We also put their metadata, more metadata than is usually present. So we put there the name of the repository where the PIDs handle, the title, and so on. This is being done dynamically. Okay, so we don't need to go to the handle server and manually with each change update the handle. Metadata, it's from the database, and it's for every request, it's being done dynamically if it's the authoritative request. From the assessment, you have to have accessible SIMD format with the @ format is equal to SIMD. And also, if you request the format XSIMD XML accept type, you can see how to do that on that wiki. It depends on which web server you are using. We have it for Nginx there, and you can also in the issues somewhere see it for Apache. But it's mentioned there how to do that. Okay, so that means PIDs. Basically getting it from an external organization, Epic or Handle, and then just do those partial identifier, which is the configuration in a web server. So it's also straightforward because the Lynda repository automatically works with handles. Okay, those four we can somehow help you with, but only partially. So let's have a look. These are the logos we are using. You should use probably your own. We are using the default Clarin one. In the assessment, you have to make the link to the National Center or to Clarin itself. So it depends on you. And basically that's it. So now let's try to install the DSpace. So these are some requirements. Again, it's from the wiki page. Those are, I would say, pretty standard ones. So and for Java database, we are running on Postgres, Java specific, JDK, Tomcat, Maven. We are also using Make and then the web server. If you have this, you can start installing that. If you are not sure how to proceed, as Amir already mentioned, we use a Vagrant, which has a complete installation script attached. So it somehow installs these prerequisites, and then an installation script is executed. So if you would follow that script, you should be able to install your repository very easily. That's why we also provide this Vagrant. But these are the prerequisites. Then you have to have a DSpace user, or that's now this is more of a recommendation. So create a DSpace user, create a Postgres DSpace user for the database. Again, mentioned on the wiki. Just okay. So on the operating system, have these two users. We strongly recommend to use PIVIC for statistics, because I usually get requests, very specific requests on how many users outside of the Czech Republic access these and these resources. It would be very, very difficult to get this information from the logs or from any repository itself, which does not really put a lot of effort into the statistics. we use PIVIC, which is a standalone application that is only for statistics, and it can give you all this information there. It's supported directly by Lynda DSpace. You just in the configuration fill out two tokens and two numbers which identify the websites, and that's it. We gather the statistics for accesses of the user interface, downloads, which is a specific one, and then OAI PMH, which is what we call a machine interface, so we also don't count this into user access. But those are probably six values in the configuration which you can get from the PIVIC web application. Make sure that PIVIC is HTTPS friendly and it's HTTPS including all the intermediate certificates, because that's what our repository is very sensitive to. Okay, so about the installation. So either use Vagrant for demo, but what you should do when you clone the repository, you should change the local properties. You don't need to, it depends on which software stack you are using, but you can change a file called variable.makefile, which specifies the users which are being used there, and then start and stop the stack. If you are using Nginx, it should be out of the box. If you are using Apache, there is like an example, or maybe vice versa, maybe Apache is the default one. But these are four files which you have to change, and then it's the standard procedure. Put your web applications to Tomcat, just a comment, make sure it runs UTF-8. In Shibboleth configuration, you have to tell Shibboleth that the repository / Shibboleth login is the one which should be secured by a Shibboleth authorization module, and then you basically execute three commands in a specific directory: create databases, install libraries, and a new deploy. And that's it. If you want to redeploy, which means that you have made some changes, or it means that you just did a git pull because we have made some changes, then it means make deploy. It will copy all the necessary, it will compile and copy the files, and then make restart. So these are three commands, or basically two commands, which mean that you will restart all the stack. It will be done automatically. So this is very also important, that we simplify the 20 steps into these basically two commands. The directory structure, the default one which we use is, let's say, / opt and / Lynda DSpace or Lynda repository, and then we have the AAI. I already told you this is the AI repository. I'm sorry, I will have to update the presentation. This is the old link. And the common theme is also in GitHub. Both are on GitHub. So you will have to clone this repositories with the common theme that was not meant to be shared. It should be used for inspiration. That's the header and the footer. What I suggest is that you clone it and then you create your own repository where you make those changes. The common theme is being used in our center throughout the services, which has one big advantage: we are tracking the accesses in a consistent way across all of our services. So when someone asks me how many accesses are to that service, I can give him a comparable number to the accesses to another service. So this is maybe a minor technical detail, but it has kind of severe consequences in a good sense. We usually have the configuration in a specific directory, which are then being symlinked. I strongly suggest you are using a local Git repository so you see the changes, and if somebody deletes it or so, you can easily get back. So that's the configs directory. Then there is the handle server, which is an external bundle. It's part of Lindat, but of Lindat repository, but we use it separately because it also runs separately. Then there is the installation directory, which is being used by Tomcat, and that one is automatically created, and then the source, which is on GitHub. So these are the six directories we also have in our installation. Okay, now some more information about the actual content of the repository, which is not so much related to the repository itself. As I mentioned, there is the data protection code of conduct, and one of the requirements for that is that you have a privacy policy somewhere available, and this is what you have to do in the service provider metadata, include a link, so you have to have that file available somewhere, and the file privacy policy can be downloaded from. You can see it, you can use the template we have at that one. So this is the data protection code of conduct. Related to intellectual property rights, there are these web pages. Make sure if you install DSpace to read them. There is a lot of information. It will take you a lot of time, but you have to make sure when you install the repository, you know what it does, how it does, and why it does it that way. There are policies, frequently asked questions about terms of services, for example. So if you deploy and you are serving the Lindat DSpace repository, make sure you acknowledge and agree with everything what we mentioned there. There is a lot of policy decisions to be made. I hope we have done a lot of good decisions for you, which are in general good, but there are some specific for us in our view, so maybe some things need to be changed. All of these pages, also Java files, JavaScript files, and the files which might need to be changed are being in such a directory structure that can be overlaid. In other words, if you create an overlay directory, which is well described in our wiki, and you put there the files, those files will be used over what we have. In this way, you can use our own source tree, which will not be modified by you, but your modifications will still take precedence over our changes. This way you can localize some very specific strings. This way you can change the Java code as mentioned and other functionality. With the localization, we have already mentioned that you just use the messages XML and add your local to the configuration. Now, this is also a very specific functionality which you need because we are using the standalone discovery. So there is the Shibboleth service provider that parses the feeds which you specified, but those do not include information, for example, about the logos, or don't need to. So what we do is we also in the repository itself merge this information from specific other repositories, entity repositories from DiscoJuice, for example. So there is the Shibboleth disco feed, then there is the DiscoJuice disco feed, we merge them and that's what we use. That's why you see a lot of logos in our identity discovery list, and geographical location and some other things which normally are not present in that. This is what I said now. The entities which are visible by DiscoJuice are inside this AI config file, which you have to change for Lindat. One of the assessment requirements is the OAI PMH interface. We have already spoken about that quite a lot. So the only thing is that you should check the status at the catalog clearing, whether it's being harvested. And if you would like to use the Weblicht SIMD service like we have it here, then that's also available in our Linda D space, but that's, I would say, like an advanced functionality. From this, I would like to mention that we can serve also those very specific CMD files. That's the functionality. That's why the original, that's the original reason why the functionality was there, where you upload the CMD file and it is being served to the OAIPMH, because we are exporting our services to Weblicht, or one of our services to Weblicht as well. We are using these profiles. It's mentioned in the actual pages in Linda D space. In the frequently asked questions, you can get to these profiles, so including the links. Both of them contain IsoCAD concept list, so we think those are pretty much good CMD profiles. Okay, regarding the CMD, this is the technical way how to do this, CMD formats based on the accept header and the query string, specifically for Nginx. As I told you, it's on the wiki page on GitHub. So it was just mentioned here, just so that you see it's pretty easy. So if the HTTP accept header is something like CMD, XML CMD, go to the repository /OAI and so on. The actual versions and always updated are on the wiki of GitHub. For the data seal of approval, we have a link in the footer, so you can always get inspired, because it's publicly available, how we do that or how the other centers are doing that. So that's what I would like to say. At the moment, the data seal of approval has been prolonged. So the actual 2014 and 15 is valid till 2017. There is a new data seal of approval version, which has some changes into the process. So yeah, you should get the latest information on that. But basically, be prepared to answer specific questions, so your admin should be part of this document, because it says about long-term support and other aspects. What's the time? 15 minutes? Okay, so regarding the branding, again, one of the assessment requirements, logo is visible, make sure either your national center clearing or the clearing itself. What I told you is something we call the overlays. So it's mentioned here, if you want to change the favicon, the theme itself, for example, so you don't like those three columns, you would like to put a line there, use those overlays. Because of the overlays, you will still have our own code untouched by you, so you can anytime do a git pull, and unless it touches the same files, you will have the latest version, and then just make deploy and make restart. There are some suggestions to the metadata what Amir showed. Again, I don't want to go into details really now, it's on the wiki. We have done a lot of effort to put all this information on the wiki page. So from this, you should only get the information that you have to do some changes. But based on the DSpace version, Some of them are not required anymore because of the REST API. That's very important to mention. We are trying to move to the standard REST API of Lynda DSpace. Again, the latest version on GitHub wiki page. I would ask you, if you are going to install that, install our Lynda repository, don't hesitate to give us feedback. If you want to ask a question, definitely other centers would like to know the same, so ask and we will include it in the wiki. The last thing is the cent registry. So when you install the repository, you have to put the information about the OAIP image endpoints entity ID into the centers at clarin.eu. You have to register your center on this web link, and finally ask the service provider federation to propagate all the metadata to those members of SPF. Because the Lynda repository consists of several applications, at least our installation, we strongly suggest to use some form of monitoring like Nagios Isinga. We have done that, so we can share it. You can see it, for example, here. We also have like integration of the monitoring of various services in our content management system. It has proven itself because, well, problems happen, and it's good that you know that your handle server is not working. That's a very important thing, and it can happen because of many reasons. So we strongly suggest that you implement this monitoring of the services. Okay, thank you. So that was maybe too quick, I would say, but we have 15 minutes. So please, unless you really want the lunch, then ask questions. So maybe I'll show one more thing. So we have the
question
yes.
Regarding this Git pull thing. There has been some discussions about don't do this now, do it like this, do it like that. Is there a fail proof?
So the process of Lynda repository, basically we are doing releases. And inside these releases, there is like detailed information of how to upgrade from the latest release. However, the releases are not so often, so maybe you would like to, from time to time, see those changes. If you are familiar with Git, then you can do a Git diff to the origin and you can see the list of changes. And when you know that those are only minor ones, then you can do a Git pull and make. But apart from that, we are on a release-based development mode. So inside those releases, really detailed information. If there are some changes which require other tools, other modifications, either from the admin or from the DSpace utility, which can do some curation, which can do some more things. So it's based on the release. We would like to have one release per month, but not sure whether we are getting there. But we had a release 1 month ago, maybe, like this. Okay, any other questions? So with the assessment, just to sum it up, it will not be done automatically. Moreover, the most of the time you will spend, as I told you, with AAI, but you have almost everything done. So the second most time-consuming task should be reading the information in the pages, frequently asked questions, policies, and acknowledge that and approve that. That can take some time because it consists of all the technologies discussed here, from SIMD to the PIDs to the AAI, so it's kind of complex task. But it's there. We really try to document everything. The Only thing is that you have to also localize this, or you should localize these pages when you want to have a local version. It depends on you, and sometimes it's kind of difficult. But it's doable. The localization is supported.
Time in this deciding how many collections to create, and I still think that maybe we're not we haven't made the right decision, but in the sense that I thought we had at some point we decided okay we do what you have done, so okay we have our community for the ILC people, so the ILC resources and tools, and also a collection which contains all these tools and resources. Resources and data, whatever it was called. And now, inside this collection, we want to put different types of resources, some that have limited access, and some that will be basically downloadable by everyone. So, is this a correct choice or not?
I would strongly suggest that yes, we have discussed this only, I would say, briefly, but according to our experience, when a user came and he saw a community, then he was like, what is a community? Mm-hmm. Maybe now for the people who are working with libraries, a community and a collection are pretty basic things. Mm-hmm. But from our experience, the users, when they see collection, they have a different opinions on what a collection is. Mm-hmm. So we try to really hide this notion. From the technical point of view, you have to have a community collection. Mm-hmm. That's why we have it. The only reason for us to have two is because we are the language resource archive for Clarin.
That is probably the same thing for us. So we assume that we create different communities for different institutions if other institutions want to give us the data. But then basically we were thinking about having this kind of identity between the collection and the community. So that basically there is just one collection for each community.
Right. What I would do is I would have one community and one collection and put everything there. Just really community and collections are, they have their own metadata. So again, it depends a bit what you want to do further with that, but only because it's being submitted by another repository, by another institute, that for me doesn't qualify into a specific collection or community. So if you want to have a logo for that or something.
That is the only reason why we thought maybe people want to identify themselves with their own institution and see the logo.
Right, but for us it's really the repository, and even also when you search, you know, for example, Google, then you don't have it really distinguished by the companies or whatever. Well, kind of maybe depends, but still you want to search not in, you know, 20 collections. You want to search, put there the text, and find all the results.
Yes.
That's at least how we look at
so
that.
It's only a political choice if you want to have this logo thing, but otherwise as little as possible.
Okay. Right, but you know, even where the logo would be, if the first, you know, you can still have the logo inside the one hit from the search. So
in each item.
So, yeah. So what we have here, as you can see, here's lynn.clarin. So if you want to have a logo here, fine. But for us, I wouldn't like to have a logo for each of the item, or, you know, prefer one community or collections. I want to have a list of the results. And I'm sorry. So this is how we see it. It's, you don't see any really collection, the notion of collections or the notion of communities here.
I think the real advantage is the customizable workflows. And also, if you are doing it for different institutions, then maybe there are separate group of people who might do the editing and the quality control, there it's important to have multiple collections, because without different collections, you cannot assign different people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So far, I would say that the experience overall has been that, you know, the kind of administrators of projects and so on would like to see collections of their projects and things like that.
Yeah, but
users couldn't care less.
Can,
users want simple, and they are pushing us towards simpler than it is, easier to see immediately the results and so on. They do not really care what project does this come from.
Yes,
and
but
so
the
also.
Authorization, so. I mean, to the download, which is my initial concern, can be managed at item level. So it does, you don't need to worry about create collections of items that need to all have the same authorization.
So it's in our repository, that's based on licenses.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. So we define licenses, and based on licenses, we decide whether to log in or not, whether anonymous access is there or not.
But if I want, yeah, I have a set of licenses that can only be downloaded by people that are from from Pisa.
Yeah. You can define it
in the license. So and then I will always take care to apply that license to those items, no matter which collection or whatever they belong. Okay.
And then the authentication would be done by a shibboleth.
Yes, that's.
So how would you need to? Okay, and that would be defined somewhere in the DSpace setup, would it? That you. Require shibboleth authenticates via their Pisa IDP. Is that possible? That's what we're asked about. That's what I need to do as well. There are some things which are only available locally that
yeah.
we might like to have in.
Well, we'll have to, yeah, I guess that we will have to tell people, even if they are sitting inside their office, sorry, but you have to authenticate.
Well, not necessarily. It's something we are not using. We decided not to use it. But DSpace has multiple authorization options, and you can combine them. So you can actually orthogonally decide that people from these IP addresses have direct access to something. As I said, we are not doing that, we are not combining these things, but it is theoretically possible to set it up this way.
What we have done...
Assign roles to specific users.
Exactly, we have done that before. Like if you come from this IDP, then you already are... you are able to... you are able to submit to that specific collection. That was what we had at the beginning. Now we put it onto the user because we found out that when there is a shared resource also from other places or people, you know, many times submit items to our, to the Lindat one, but through other IDPs. So at the end of the day, we also remove that. But yes, it can be done. Looking, for example, at the IDP or at some attributes which you know that IDP is sending, like that my role is a member of Institute of Formal and Applied Linguistics, so I can be automatically an admin. We are not doing that; it can be done. But apart from that, that's also related to your questions. Almost every item in this space can have authorization. So you have an item, Alex context, and here you can edit that item, and here you can see authorizations. So you can say, at the moment we have that it can read anonymous, anybody can read that, and so on. It can be changed. You can change here. You can put more policies that specific person can modify it. That's, for example, what we use in the LRT collection. There was a requirement that metadata can be updated by the submitters of LRT items. We don't allow this for the Lindat collection. So when you submit, you want to change metadata, you have to go through us. But the requirements for LRT was that if you submit into LRT, you should be able to change the metadata, not the data. We will record all the changes, but you should be able to do that. So, for example, that's where the authorization comes into place. But for each item, for each collection, for each community, even for each step on the submission workflow, you can create these authorizations.
And per license as well. So if I wanted to say, assign a license to all the things, a particular license to all the things that are only open to people locally.
Maybe we don't understand each other, or I'm not understanding you, but the licenses which you select, the CC licenses, are attached to the submissions. So they are attached only in one place, and that's the submission workflow or edit item, whatever, but they are attached to submissions. So when then you come to an item which has a file, so let's say the restricted ones. So here I say that the write should be, for example, restricted. Then the then here you can see that the item contains three files, and where is the page down?
So you can use the
Okay. And here, if you want to, well, I'm now logged in. Okay. So if I log out, yeah, then I have to go once again. Okay. So rights restricted. So this is accessible for anyone. You can, again, what you can do is you can restrict also the metadata, but we strongly suggest not to do so. But here is when the license comes. So if you want to download the file, you have to authenticate before. Okay, so I authenticate, because Amir is an admin, it should be started automatically.
Okay, so DSpace sends you to authentication there. Is it because of something that's being set at the item level, or because of the license that is attached?
Because of the license.
So it's the license that actually defines, also it's basically implemented.
Okay, so so you're right, the ICE, the license is like the authorization to the download of that particular file. Yes.
Yeah.
So that's like additional authorization. You're right.
But we currently don't have functionality that can restrict that from a specific IDP, you can download this file. But that can be achievable based on licenses as well, but you need some tweaking in the code.
Yeah, okay, so right. You have to, yeah, okay, you have to change it. It's not the licensing is a bit different to the administration you saw there, which you can click. The licenses are attached, and you specify in the license, I need authenticated users. In other words, I need identifiable users. Maybe you need some more information, but that's it, what you can say at the moment.
But if I want to say for a particular license, they need to be member at?
Not possible at the moment.
But I could do it at a per item level.
Yes, but then you would have to probably make it on the read level, which means that even the metadata would not be visible. I would know, maybe the item level, but yeah, maybe the item level itself, yeah. So yes, it should be possible.
Because there's 20 things that would be nice to put in there, the things that we've licensed from the LDC, so we can't redistribute them, but we'd like Oxford people can use them. So we could do them on a per item basis. We've also got 28,000 things which are currently only available in Oxford, but in 2 years' time will be made publicly available, so we want to store them in there, make them available in Oxford now, and then we've changed the permissions when they come into the public domain in 2 years' time.
That's something we call the embargo. Mm. So when you go to that item,
but in their requirement, those items are still available for.
Yes, but with the embargo, and you can put that still that the users with this rights have also read permissions to that, because embargo basically just changes the read permissions to specific group. So in the edit this item, here we have something called embargo, which when you can change that, it will not allow you to download unless you have it explicitly in an authorization.
But the metadata would be visible, would it?
Metadata would be visible,
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So but if you actually also the file would be visible, but when you click on it, it will say this will be up, this will be available after this date.
And if I want these things to be currently available to local users,
right? So then you would have to go to the item status authorization, and you would here have to add, for example, the Bitstream policy, and you would say that a specific group of people, okay, your local ones, okay, have the read permission anyway.
Okay, so you have to create a group.
You have to create with all the people inside, or you would have to change a bit of the code, but it's already there, but not in that way, saying if you come from this IDP, you're automatically granted this group. We have been using that, but a lot of months before, so we will have to check how it's being done, whether it's still working.
If you want to not change the code, you have to take the pain of enumerating
exactly
all the people. Okay, I see.
And also, if you have that many items, like thousands of items, then it's better to create a collection and assign that collection the permission. Otherwise, it's very difficult to do it.
Yeah, well, you could actually do it using the REST API, which is at the moment not so difficult. But yes, in those very rare and specific cases, the distinguishment in the collections might have sense.
Because you have to edit every item.
Yeah, because again, for example, these are the communities and collections in what we have. So this is the web services for the SIMD related, but data and tools, and yeah, I can edit this collection, for example, and I have the roles, the metadata, and I can change them. So here is the authorization. So who is the submitter? Who is the accept reject step? Like Amir showed before, and I can create a group saying that this can, the default, for example, read access, I can restrict that, the default read access, which is what. But I have to also admit we haven't been using that, so this is the dSpace functionality itself, so it's well documented on dSpace, but we haven't been using these features. So maybe some more tweaks would be necessary to get what you really want, but at least the basics are there. Okay, so I think the time is up. So any